So far, the biggest issue with studying exoplanets in general is that they are usually only indirectly studyable. Astronomers may see the gravitational tug of an exoplanet on its parent star and work out things like the planet's mass from that, or even atmospheric data can be collected or inferred from methods like observing planetary transits. But overall, direct observation of exoplanets remains very difficult. This is set to change as new instrumentation comes online, and not only could we determine what an exoplanet is like, we may also very well be able to tell if it has life, analogs of plants, and even civilizations present on their surfaces. For an in-depth discussion of habitable exoplanet possibilities, I recently spoke with Dr. Avi Loeb of Harvard about it, but also lots of other topics within astrobiology. We covered a lot of bases. This interview debuts on my new channel, Event Horizon with JMG, later today at 5 p.m. Central. For those that wanted longer content from me, this one went an hour and a half, and is just an amazing interview, so check that out later today. Past that, the emerging main way to study potentially habitable exoplanets is by studying the composition of their atmospheres. We know from Earth that life profoundly affects our atmospheric composition, with what would appear to other civilizations to be bizarre concentrations of oxygen and methane, where perhaps life would be the most likely source. Except, it's not a dead ringer. There would always be the possibility that abiotic, geological, or chemical processes were creating these gases in some odd way. If we see these kinds of odd mixes of gases in exoplanet atmospheres, we will need more to say definitively that they are due to life than merely the gases alone. Luckily, there are other things astronomers can look at. In a paper by Svetlana V. Berdyugina and colleagues linked below, they detail the other ways we might confirm if an exoplanet suspect of supporting life actually does. Seemingly the best way to do this would be to attempt to image the surface of the exoplanet itself. While we are very far from an actual, detailed image of an exoplanet, we very likely would have to go to that exoplanet for that, there are things that can be gleaned from very distant, direct imaging. In addition to studying atmospheric gases, it may be possible to determine if an exoplanet experiences seasons, what its cloud cover is like, and if analogs of plant life are producing oxygen through photosynthesis through a similar structure to Earth plants. We may even see direct evidence of that, because plants, at least ours, become highly reflective in infrared, creating a so-called red edge that could hypothetically be detected. And, of course, there's always the possibility of picking up technosignatures if an exocivilization exists on a planet. The authors detail that there are two approaches for imaging exoplanets, direct and indirect. Direct would be to construct bigger telescopes or interferometers, such as the proposed ExoLife Finder telescope, either based on Earth or in space, or to send out spacecraft on long-term journeys to directly image these planets, though that's a bit taller of an order by nature. They predict that if funding is available, current technology could produce an exoplanet imaging telescope within a decade. Indirectly studying exoplanet details is more within reach. In fact, we've been doing it for some time with solar system objects. This comes from analyzing the light curves of the planets themselves, essentially studying the characteristics of the light coming from them, either reflecting off them or showing variations in the light curves. Here, the James Webb Space Telescope will be invaluable, especially when studying potentially habitable exoplanets in infrared. With rocky planets, studying albedo as exoplanets orbit and rotate could allow scientists to work out features present on an exoplanet's surface, though only the largest features could be worked out. Even the colors of these features might be discerned, such as white for an ice cap or brown for a continent, or if you were looking back at Earth, green for vegetation, though the actual color of exoplanets probably wouldn't be green. And there's always the chance of spotting a technosignature. Quite a few have been put forth that we might detect, such as huge photovoltaic systems, i.e. solar panels, that would reflect light in a recognizable way. Ultimately, though, the indirect method and the direct method will yield clues to how exoplanets are, especially close ones like Proxima B, but they won't be breathtaking high-resolution images unless we send a spacecraft there or build telescopes of such a size that they would probably be prohibitively expensive for the foreseeable future. But there may be other ways, such as using the sun's gravitational lensing to magnify planets behind it. That may be far easier to accomplish. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently worried about detecting exoplanets. While plant intelligence is a subject of some debate, Earth plants are actually quite unsettling in other ways. They can reproduce at a distance, you can nearly kill them and they just regenerate, and some of them can live for centuries or more. The moment the human species becomes complacent in our 100,000-year war of attrition with them, they'll pop through the pavement, take back over, thrive, and win. And that's not even broaching the concept of carnivorous plants, the worst kind, especially if you're an insect. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular, in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.